Hello viewers and aspirants, welcome to the Hindi News Analysis brought to you by Shankar Ice Academy for the date 15th of November 2021. So these are the list of news articles that will be discussed today. So on those lines, we're going to discuss about a beautiful butterfly. We'll be discussing about online violence such as cyberbullying and how it affects children. And we'll also discuss about a particular community and an initiative of IIT. And we'll also see about the Unified Payments Interface. Along with these discussions, we'll be discussing about the hot topic of the day, which is the Glasgow Climate Pact. So with this introduction, now let us move on to the first news article discussion for today. Now, let us take up this article for discussion. Now, this article talks about the evolution of UPI, that is Unified Payments Interface. The article also discusses about how UPI has made our life easier. And finally, it discusses the risks that are associated with UPI transactions. So in this discussion, we are going to discuss in detail about UPI, its benefits, and also the disadvantages. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, this UPI, that is Unified Payments Interface, is the genesis of a revolution in the digital transaction. We'll see why. First, let us understand what is this UPI. So it is a real-time payment system. Now, this payment system helps in instant transfer of funds between two bank accounts. So that is instant transfer of funds. Now, such transfer of funds is usually done through a mobile application. And we have the mobile applications like PhonePe, GPay, Amazon Pay, and even Bheem app. So it is a payment system which makes instant transfer of funds between two bank accounts. Now note that this UPI is an initiative taken by the National Payments Corporation of India, NPCI, along with the Reserve Bank of India and the Indian Banks Association. So three entities have been involved in this initiative. And this initiative was launched in 2016. And you should also note that UPI is considered as an advanced version of IMPS, that is Immediate Payment System. We use this IMPS while using internet banking. And if you note, this IMPS is also an initiative of the National Payments Corporation of India. So keeping these facts in mind, now let us discuss the advantages or the benefits of UPI. See, first of all, UPI ensures immediate transfer of money, that is immediate fund transfer. Secondly, UPI is available 24/7 and it is available on 365 days. Therefore, UPI transaction can be done even during bank holidays. Thirdly, it is very simple to use. As you know, if you want to use this technology, then you can simply pick up your phone and you can install the application like GPay. Now, this application will ask you to authenticate your SIM through an OTP process, that is one-time password process. This process will enable you to link your bank account, which is linked to the same mobile number. And if you do this process, then after that, you can easily start the transaction. It is as simple as that. But if you remember before this, UPI, that is around 2015, we had Paytm, and to make a transaction, we have to take certain steps in Paytm. For example, first you have to have a Paytm wallet, then you have to load the wallet with money from your bank account. That is, from your bank account, the money is transferred to the Paytm wallet first. And then while making payment, you have to send the money to the receiver's wallet. That is, from that Paytm wallet of yours, you are transacting the money to the Paytm wallet of that receiver. And then the receiver again has to transact that money from the Paytm wallet to their bank account. So this was a tedious process, but this process has been made simpler through this UPI, because now we can directly send the money from our bank account to the receiver's bank account. So in this manner, UPI enables us to send or receive money between person to person and also between person to merchants. Additionally, we can also send money using QR code, virtual payment number, phone number, and even using bank account, that is using IFSC code. More importantly, when we are making payment to a merchant using this UPI application, you and merchant need not have the same mobile application. Rather, we have to just scan the QR code and initiate the transaction. Now, this helps the merchant to tap customers who do not have a debit card or credit cards. So, it enables a large number of people to participate in a digital transaction. and it doesn't demand any debit card or credit card. Then you should also remember that UPI allows us to link more than one of our bank accounts to the UPI-based mobile application. And then UPI is also a method of payment which is cost-effective than using a credit card or internet banking. It is because we know that while using credit card or internet banking, there are certain additional charges, but there is no such charge associated with UPI. So in this manner, it is also cost-effective. And finally, there is also grievance redressal in UPI payments, because any complaints regarding the transaction can also be raised from the mobile application itself. Now, in this manner, UPI has become a technology that has cut down the socioeconomic divide seamlessly, because it is not an elitist or luxury technology. As we just saw, anyone can use it. So in this way, UPI has democratized digital transaction and it is accessible to everyone. And because of such advantages, UPI-based mobile transactions are on the rise compared to the other modes of transactions like credit card or internet banking, because nowadays these are only used by a minuscule population in our country. See, according to a data of National Payments Corporation of India, about 3.24 billion transactions were made via UPI in the month of July 2021 itself. And these transactions were worth 6.06 trillion rupees. So you can imagine how much prominence this mobile applications and mode of transaction. But we should also remember that beyond all these advantages, there are also certain disadvantages, mainly because it is a digital technology. So it is easily used to defraud people. This is what this news article particularly mentions as the other digital divide. See, what is happening is that the fraudsters are using simple confidence tricks to cheat people rather than using high-tech methods like hacking. And such fraudulent activities are possible due to the inadequate digital awareness that is present among the population. And it also provides a ground for confusion. For example, let us see how the fraudsters are exploiting. See, we know that to send money via UPI, we need to enter PIN. But on the other hand, if we are the person who is receiving money, then we do not need to enter UPI PIN. But many are not aware of this particular fact. So what fraudsters are doing is that instead of paying another person or merchant, they will generate a request for money through the UPI app. And they will ask the person to approve that request. And they will say that for approving that request, they have to first enter their PIN to receive the money from this fraudulent person. But we know that only for sending money, we have to enter the PIN number. Being unaware about this fact, many are entering their PIN, and rather than receiving that particular amount of money, they are sending their money to that fraudulent person. So this is one of the examples of how fraudsters are exploiting the inadequate digital awareness among the population. Now, other than this, fraudsters are also trying to replicate the SIM by cloning it. Now, if they are able to do this, then that means they will get the OTPs and they can easily make digital transactions on our accounts. Apart from all these, there is also the issue of fake application, because UPI applications are digital applications. So a fake can be easily created. And such fake applications, if installed in our phone, they can even steal all our personal data. So these are some of the disadvantages of UPI transactions. So what steps can be taken to avoid such disadvantages? See, first and foremost is ensuring digital literacy and conducting awareness campaigns on digital safety. Because if people are educated about these fraudulent practices, and if they simply just know how to operate the application and what are the process involved in it, then we can easily avoid such fraudulent activities. Other than that, we can also keep a low balance in the bank account which is linked to the UPI application. So even if our account is hacked, or even if our account is obtained by a fraudulent person, then also we can minimize the loss. So if we follow such measures, then this UPI technology can be efficiently used. And as Bill Gates once said, UPI has made our phone as our wallet. So these are some of the points that you can take note regarding unified payments interface. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is going to be based on these two news articles which talks about the hot topic of the day. The hot topic is the recent developments in the ongoing COP26, that is Conference of Parties 26 under the UNFCCC agreement. And as the recent development is that, yesterday, important decisions and agreements were made between the parties, and these were made as part of the Glasgow Climate Pact. So in this regard, these news articles also throws light on the role played by India regarding the decisions. So let us see these important decisions now. Before that, the syllabus relevant to this discussion has been highlighted here. See, as we have already discussed many times, the COP meetings are held every year, and they are held mainly to construct a global response to climate change. Now, in each of these meetings, the parties to the convention, that is the UNFCCC, they produce a set of decisions. And this year's decision has been called the Glasgow Climate Pact. And if you remember, before this pact, the previous COP meetings delivered two important international agreements. They are the Kyoto Protocol of 1997, and the other one was the Paris Agreement of 2015. Now, here you should note that among these two, the Kyoto Protocol expired last year, and only the Paris Agreement remains to be the active instrument to fight climate change. So, coming to the Glasgow Climate Pact that has been agreed in the COP26, let us see these decisions one by one. It is very important from the exam perspective. These decisions can be directly asked in your prelims as separate statements, or a mains question can be framed based on these decisions. So let us see these one by one. Now, firstly, the COP emphasized on the need to have a stronger action in the current decade in order to achieve the 1.5 degree target. See, as you know, the 1.5 degree target was put forward by the Paris Agreement. That is, the target was to reduce the rise in global temperature, and that to keep this rise below 2 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial level, or pursue efforts to limit it to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So this recent pact also emphasized on the need to have a stronger action regarding this target. And on that line, the agreement has called for a phase down of coal and phase out of fossil fuels. So in this regard, you should remember that the Glasgow Climate Pact is the first ever climate deal to explicitly plan to reduce coal. So this is an important fact for prelims. So in this regard, many countries have also admitted taking initiatives. For example, around 28 new members have signed up an alliance called as the Powering Past Coal Alliance. Now this is the world's largest alliance on phasing out coal. And on a similar manner, around 20 new countries, they have committed themselves to build no new coal plants. That is, they will not build any coal plants. Now, these countries include Vietnam, Morocco, and Poland. Other than this, even some major emerging economies, they also took significant steps to move from coal to clean power. So, in this regard, the step taken by India is also important. See, India, along with Indonesia, Philippines, and South Africa, these countries together have announced partnership with the Climate Investment Funds. So as part of this partnership, Climate Investment Funds has launched nearly $2.5 billion of Accelerating Coal Transition Investment Program. And this program is the first ever effort to advance a just transition from coal power to clean energy in the emerging economies. So one of the decisions taken by India as part of phasing down coal is the partnership with Climate Investment Funds. Or we can say that Climate Investment Funds has chosen the countries of India, Indonesia, Philippines, and South Africa for this Accelerating Coal Transition Investment Program. Now, in this regard, you should also note that India played a key role by intervening to arrive at the final text of the agreement. Let us understand what India did. See, previously in the agreement, there was a provision called all parties to accelerate phase out of coal and fossil fuel subsidies. So initially, a draft document mentioned that accelerating phase out of coal and fossil fuel subsidies. So for both coal and fossil fuels, phase out was suggested, but most nations, including India, were against this phrase. Why? Because many countries around the world have already attained high levels of growth using fossil fuels. We know that. And even now, many developed countries have not completely phased out coal itself. So, at such a scenario, asking the developing countries like India to phase out coal is not a just decision according to India. And this decision of India is based on many factors. For example, if we look at the first factor, when we consider the convention, that is UNFCCC, it only refers to the mitigation of greenhouse gas emissions from all sources. That is, this emission reduction is more general and it has not been directed at any particular source. So due to this, phasing out of particularly coal was not agreed by India and some countries. Now the second factor is that, as we already said, developed countries have made use of fossil fuels for their growth. So similarly, even the developing countries have got right to their fair share of global carbon budget. And therefore, they are also entitled to the responsible use of fossil fuels within this scope. See here, you should understand the term global carbon budget. It refers to the amount of greenhouse gases that can be spent, that is, that can be emitted for a given level of global warming. So that means if this budget exceeds, then the global temperatures will become higher. So that means every country should have some share in emitting greenhouse gases. And because of this reason only, India is saying that developing countries also have the right to their fair share of global carbon budget. Now, apart from this, there is also one more factor. That is, if phasing out fossil fuel was the real aim, then all the three main fossil fuels should be reduced. That is, all coal, oil and gas should be reduced. But this is not the case. Only reducing coal is emphasized in the deal. Why? Because the US and other countries, other developed countries, they are refusing to target oil and gas as these two are critical to their own economies. So in the similar manner, according to India, coal is also critical to the growth of the economies of developing countries. And that is why India was stiff on its decision and it opposed for the phase out of coal along with fossil fuel subsidies. And due to this, initially the phrase was watered down. In the subsequent draft, it was changed to phase out of unabated coal power and insufficient fossil fuel subsidies. But even then, the developing countries were not okay with this phrase. So finally, after days of negotiation, India managed to convince the parties to include coal under the phase down category instead of the phase out. So now, phase down of coal along with phase out of fossil fuels has been agreed by the COP parties. So this decision of India has played a major role in the global carbon budget of developing countries. Now, along with this, the COP26 also concluded with a resolution. This resolution decided to revisit and strengthen the existing emission targets by 2022. Now, apart from this, another remarkable decision that was made at COP26 was with respect to carbon market. See, carbon markets came into existence under the Kyoto Protocol Clean Development Mechanism, that is CDM. So let us refresh what is the CDM. CDM allows emission reduction projects in developing countries to earn certified emission reduction credits. Now, each of this credit is equivalent to 1 ton of carbon dioxide. And these credits can be further traded, sold and used by industrialized countries. And these industrialized countries can buy and use these credits to meet a part of their emission reduction targets under the Kyoto Protocol. So let us understand this concept even more simply. See, basically, a carbon market will allow the countries or industries to earn a certain amount of carbon credits. So how we can earn a carbon credit? It can be earned with each emission reductions the countries make in excess of their targets. For example, if our target was to achieve 20% reduction, but we have achieved 25%, then that means we have achieved 5% more emission reduction. Now, this 5% is our carbon credit, and this can be traded, sold to the industrialized economies. And these carbon credits is traded to the highest bidder in exchange of money. So what will the buyers of such carbon credits will do? They can show the emission reductions as their own. That is, they have got this 5% from us. No, they can show this 5% carbon reduction as their own emissions reduction. And then they can use them to meet their reduction targets. So this was the Clean Development Mechanism and carbon market under it And as I told you earlier, this carbon market existed under Kyoto Protocol. But in the beginning itself, we saw that Kyoto Protocol expired last year. And therefore, this carbon market is also no longer in existence according to the news article. And therefore, a new market under Paris Agreement is yet to become functional in place of this carbon market. But there is an issue here. It is that developing countries like India, China or Brazil, they have got large amount of these carbon credits left over. And this is due to the lack of demand, as many countries already abandoned their emission reduction targets. So therefore, these developing countries wanted their unused carbon credits to be transitioned to the new market. But the developed countries are not okay with this plan. Therefore, there was a deadlock between the developing countries and the developed countries regarding the carbon credits. And now a solution has been found for this in the Glasgow Pact. The solution is that now the agreement allows these carbon credits to be used in meeting the country's first nationally determined contribution targets. That means these carbon credits cannot be used for meeting targets in subsequent nationally determined contributions. See, if you remember, under the Paris Agreement, the countries agreed nationally determined contributions under which targets were set. So now, under the Glasgow Pact, what has been agreed is that if a developed country wants to buy these credits to meet its own emission reduction targets, then it can do so only till 2025. Why 2025? Because most countries have already presented climate targets for 2025 in their first NDCs. And the Glasgow Pact clearly says they can use the carbon credits in their first NDC targets only. And that is why these can be only used till 2025. So this was the change in the carbon credits mechanism. So that is all. These are the important decisions taken in the Glasgow Pact. First, we saw about the phase down of coal and phase out of fossil fuel subsidies. Then we saw about revisiting and strengthening the existing emission targets by 2022. Then we also in between saw about the reasons for why India was reluctant in phasing out of coal. We saw the important factors behind it. And finally, we saw the changes regarding the carbon markets and carbon credits. So with this information, I'll just move on to the next discussion. Now, our next discussion is going to be based on this news article, which talks about a butterfly species. So the news article reports that the state cabinet headed by the chief minister of Arunachal Pradesh has recently approved a butterfly as the state butterfly. This butterfly is the Kesari Hind butterfly. So in this regard, let us see few facts about this Kesari Hind butterfly. So it is a large, bright-colored swallowtail butterfly. See, swallowtail butterfly is a group of butterflies and they belong to the family Papilionidae. These butterflies are generally found worldwide except in the Arctic, and their name is based on the fact that their hind wings have extensions which look like tail. That is why they're called as swallowtail. Now coming back to Kesari Hind, see, this is an elusive butterfly. That is, it is quite hard to catch. And its scientific name is Tainopalpus imperialis. And popularly, it is referred to as the Emperor of India. So you would have heard about this butterfly, the Emperor of India butterfly. Now, as you already saw, it is colorful. It has superb green, black and orange colors. So now coming to its distribution, this magnificent colorful butterfly is found along the eastern Himalayas. It is found in the areas of West Bengal, Meghalaya, Assam, Sikkim and Manipur. And it is also found in other countries like Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, Laos, Vietnam and even in southern China. And note that this butterfly generally occurs at medium and higher elevations. It occurs from about 6,000 to 10,000 feet and it occurs in a terrain which is well wooded. Another important fact to be noted is that this butterfly is very localized and it is never abundant and it only survives in intact forest. This is the main concern regarding this species because much of the forest habitat in its distribution regions is under great pressure because those forests are cut down due to logging and for development. And particularly the species is also threatened due to over-collecting and also rapid destruction of the high elevation forests upon which this species depends on. So the best way to protect this species is to protect the forest habitat where it remains and by imposing collecting restrictions. See, this butterfly is hunted for supplying to butterfly collectors. So imposing collecting restrictions will conserve this butterfly. And because of this, this Kesari Hen is protected under Schedule 2 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So basically, now this new move of Arunachal Pradesh of declaring this butterfly as the state butterfly will enhance the conservation aspects. It will also boost butterfly tourism and it will save the species from extinction in the state. Because as of now, this butterfly is confined to very few pockets of Arunachal Pradesh. If not conserved, then it will become extinct. So that is why this move of Arunachal Pradesh is expected to develop habitat conservation of this species. Now, in this regard, the news article mentions another fact that this butterfly was captured live during a butterfly watch that happened in Arunachal Pradesh's Telli Valley Wildlife Sanctuary. So, as you already said, this wildlife sanctuary is situated in Arunachal Pradesh and it lies 30 kilometers from the town of Zero in Arunachal Pradesh. This sanctuary is situated at an altitude of about 2,400 meters. And this place is a plateau with dense forest of silver fir trees, pine-clad plateau and a vast wasteland. And this area also has some of the most important endangered species like clouded leopard. So first live Kesari Hen butterfly was captured in Telli Valley Wildlife Sanctuary. So that is all. In this discussion, we saw about the Kesari Hen butterfly, where we can find this butterfly, what are the threats facing the species. And finally, we also saw about the Telli Valley Wildlife Sanctuary. With this information, let us move on to the next discussion. Now, let us take up this op-ed article for discussion. It talks about the apprehensions prevailing around the digital platforms like using social media platforms, etc. And more importantly, it also discusses about how they also affect children and youth. So we know that in these COVID times, children and youth, they are getting increased unsupervised exposure to online content. So this is one of the main reasons for increasing online violence against children and youth, which has been discussed in this op-ed article. So in this discussion, let us understand what is online violence, what are the categories involved in it, and what are the measures taken by the international community to address this issue. And we'll also see some of the way forwards to tackle this problem. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, first, if you look at the available data regarding online news, in India, we can find that 71 million children, that is around 7.1 crore children who are aged 5 to 11 years, access the internet. And they access the internet on the devices of their family members. So, children constitute about 14% of our country's active internet user base. And as you know, our internet user base is over 50 crores. Therefore, children are more susceptible to online violence. And as we saw, this article speaks about the online violence involving children and young people, particularly in school. So first, let us understand what is this online violence. See, it can be defined as the intentional use of online digital devices to cause harm or to cause discomfort on others. And this online violence involving children and young people can be divided into two categories. Before seeing that two categories, you should understand that according to United Nations, child has been defined as a person under the age of 18 years and young people have been defined as individuals in the age group of 10 to 24 years. So now what are the two categories? See, first is the violence between children and young people. This is also known as peer-to-peer violence and it is often described as cyberbullying. For example, this kind of violence includes sending hurtful, malicious or intimidating messages. Now, this is the first type of violence and the second category is the violence perpetrated by adults against the children and young people under the age of 18 years. So, this violence is perpetrated by adults. Now, this also includes sexual abuse and exploitation. And it also includes actions like joking, telling stories, or making comments about a person's body, appearance, etc. So remember, these are the two categories of online violence involving children and young people. Now, let us see some statistics related to this. For this, let us take a UNESCO's report, which is titled as Behind the Numbers, Ending School Violence and Bullying. This was a 2019 report. And according To this report, almost 1 in 3 students worldwide reported being bullied at least once in the preceding month. Now, this was about the physical bullying. And about cyberbullying, the report notes that around 1 in 10 children have experienced cyberbullying. Mainly, this report focuses on the cyberbullying of America and Europe. And based on this data, they have concluded that 1 in 10 children have experienced cyberbullying. And it also notes that cyberbullying is an increasing problem, that is, it is increasing day by day. For example, according to the report, in 7 European countries, the proportion of children aged 11 to 16 years who use the internet, they have reported that they had experienced cyberbullying. And this reporting has increased from 7% in 2010 to 12% in 2014. And the report also notes that girls are more likely to be cyberbullied than boys. And such cyberbullying happens through messages. But it should also be noted that there is less difference between the gender factor in the prevalence of cyberbullying via pictures. In addition to this, we take another study which was conducted by an organization called Plan International. It was a 2020 study. It involved 14,000 women who were aged between 15 to 25 years, and they were from 22 countries. Now, this study revealed that 58% of girls in Asia-Pacific region have reported online harassment. It also found that out of the girls who were harassed, 14% self-identified as having a disability, and around 37% identified themselves as from an ethnic minority community. And if any survey would be conducted now, then these figures will go up, because in COVID times, children are using more digital tools and platforms for online education. So the prevalence of online violence has increased. So this is the extent of problem of online violence involving children and young people. Now let us see how this is affecting the school children. That is, what are the consequences of online violence? See, children who are frequently bullied, they are nearly 3 times more likely to feel like an outsider at school. And they also have worse educational outcomes, like they get lower marks or they even fail in exams. Apart from this, these children are also more likely to expect to leave formal education after finishing secondary school. So school dropout rate is quite higher among the children who are often bullied. On top of all these, the impact of online sexual harassment even could have long-term negative impacts on the mental health and well-being of the children. So that is why online violence, including online sexual harassment and cyberbullying, is harmful for children. So in this way, certain measures have been taken by the international community to address this issue. For example, if you take UNESCO, it has taken certain measures because it is the organization that has been entrusted to lead and coordinate the education agenda in the SDG goals. And as you know, the SDG goal related to this is the SDG 4, which is to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. Now, this goal also includes ensuring safe, non-violent and inclusive learning environments. So as a part of the measures taken as part of the goal, recently the UNESCO member states have declared the first Thursday of November as the International Day Against Violence and Bullying at School, including cyberbullying. And this is the reason why this news article has appeared today. In addition to this, UNESCO, in partnership with NCRT, has also brought out measures to counter bullying in the title of Safe Online Learning in Times of COVID-19. And in our country, the Department of School Education and Literacy has also circulated guidelines about the adverse effects of online gaming and psycho-emotional stress related to it. Because online gaming is also related to cyberbullying. So these are some of the measures taken by the international community. Now, as a conclusion, let us see what needs to be done in the future to tackle this problem. See, first of all, efforts should be made to provide children with knowledge and skills to identify online violence. See, only when the violence has been identified, we can address it. So first, children should be empowered with knowledge and skills to identify online violence. And secondly, teachers should also play a critical role in this manner. See, they can teach students about online safety and they can support parental involvement while using online platforms, etc. Apart from this, confidential reporting and redress mechanism regarding the online violence should also be established. So this will give confidence to the children to report the violence easily. So while taking these measures, we should keep in mind that in this era of online education, it is very much essential to keep digital platforms free from cyberbullying to provide quality education. So these are some of the key points that you need to know about online violence, especially cyberbullying among children. As I always say, you can use these data in your mains answer writing, particularly in a topic in an essay paper that deals with the menace of digital platforms or social media platforms or involvement of children in social media platform. And you can also talk about these points in the negatives of online learning, etc. So you can judiciously use the data in this discussion for supporting your answer. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is going to be based on this news article. It mentions that potters from Unch village in Bharatpur district of Rajasthan will travel to another village to help the local clay griddle makers. They will help in fabricating the furnace of the another village people with a modified design. So what is a griddle actually? See, it is a cooking device consisting of a broad flat surface. So basically, it is like our dosa tawa, as you can see in this image. And a furnace is the place where the makers bake their earthenware. So now what is happening is the potters of Unch village, they are from Kumhar community and they have benefited from IIT Delhi's Rural Technology Action Group initiative. See, this initiative helped the potters from Unch village to build more efficient furnace. See, this furnace was less polluting and even the earthenware that was produced from this furnace had better strength, having lesser breakage. So now what the potters of Unch village are doing is that they are visiting another village and they are going to help the local clay griddle makers to fabricate better furnace. So this is the crux of the news article. So from exam perspective, what we need to focus is about this news along with the Kumhar community and the initiative which we just saw. So first, let us see about the community. See, first know that the word Kumhar is derived from the term Kumharkar. This literally means maker of Kumbha. Kumbha means earthen pot. Now, according to ancient Indian Hindu mythology, the people of this community, that is the Kumhar people, are offspring of Lord Brahma or the Lord Prajapati. Now, here you should note that the people of Kumhar community claim that they were the first inventors of the wheel. So now, where we can find the people belonging to this community in India? See, in India, they are distributed among the states of Himachal Pradesh, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Odisha, Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Gujarat. So mostly northern and western part of our country. And the people of this community speak the languages of the area where they live. So these are the important facts that you need to know about Kumhar community. Now let us see about the initiative which we just saw. See, the initiative is the Rural Technology Action Group, in short RUTAG, which is an initiative of IIT Delhi. So you should understand that this initiative was conceptualized by the Office of the Principal Scientific Officer to the Government of India. Now the main aim of this initiative is to improve the level of science and technology intervention and to support the development of technologies for rural India. So here RUTAG stands for Rural Technology Action Group. It is based on improving the livelihood of rural people. And you should note that this initiative is centered in 7 IITs. They are the IIT Bombay, Delhi, Guwahati, Kanpur, Kharagpur, Madras and Roorkee. Now the main aspect of this program is that all the technology intervention through this initiative is demand driven. That is, if people come with a problem, then this initiative will provide technology solutions. And in this manner, the initiative mostly focuses livelihood creation, drudgery reduction, increase in efficiency or productivity of processes, provisions of higher income, generation of employment, downsizing of existing technologies and local resource management and even knowledge generation. So these are the facts that you need to know about this initiative. Keep this initiative in mind. It is quite important from prelims as well as from the mains perspective. So with this discussion, now we have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. Now let us take up this previous question. It was asked in prelims 2016. The question asks, recently for the first time in our country, which of the following states has declared a particular butterfly as state butterfly? Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Karnataka and Maharashtra. See, you should remember that this question was asked in prelims 2016. And at that time, for the first time, a butterfly was declared as a state butterfly. And the correct answer to this question is option D, Maharashtra. And the state butterfly was the blue mormon. See, blue mormon is a large swallowtail butterfly. It is found primarily in Sri Lanka and India. And it is mainly restricted to the western ghats of Maharashtra, South India and coastal belts. And it is also occasionally spotted in the Maharashtrian mainland between Vidarbha and western Maharashtra. And it is reportedly the second largest butterfly found in India. So the correct answer to this question is option D, Maharashtra. It declared the blue mormon butterfly as its state butterfly. Now let us take up this pair based question and we have to choose the correctly matched pair. On one side state is given and on the other side state butterfly is given. First pair is Maharashtra common peacock. Just now we saw that Maharashtra's state butterfly is blue mormon. So first pair is incorrect. You can eliminate options A and D. Now the second pair is Arunachal Pradesh Kesari Hind. This pair is correct. You can say this based on our today's discussion. So two should be in the answer, which can also be said by the remaining options because B and C both have two and both have four also. Now we have to decide whether three is right or not. Now let us see the pair three, Uttarakhand and blue mormon. See, as we just saw, blue mormon is the state butterfly of Maharashtra and the state butterfly of Uttarakhand is common peacock. So pair 3 is incorrect. Therefore, the correct answer to this question is option C, 2 and 4 only. Now, let us take up another prelims question. This question asks, which of the following systems are operated by the National Payments Corporation of India? Unified Payments Interface, Aadhaar-enabled Payment System, National Electronic Toll Collection, National Automated Clearing House, Immediate Payment Service. See, before attending this question, let us see a few facts about NPCI. So it is an umbrella organization which operates the retail payments and settlement systems in India. And this NPCI is an initiative of the Reserve Bank of India and the Indian Banks Association. And it was formed under the provisions of Payment and Settlement Systems Act of 2007 for creating a robust payment and settlement. Now, the aim of this organization is to provide infrastructure to the entire banking system in India for physical as well as electronic payment and settlement systems. So in this regard, it operates many payment systems. It includes United Payments Interface, that is UPI, which we saw today. Then Aadhaar-enabled payment system, that is AEPS. Then FASTag, that is the National Electronic Toll Collection. Then National Automated Clearing House, Immediate Payment Service, IMPS. Then RuPay, then National Financial Switch, Bheem Aadhaar, then eRupee, Bharat Bill Pay, AutoPay, etc. So based on this list, you can easily say that all of the given systems are operated by NPCI. So the correct answer to this question is option D, all of the above. So with this question, we are going to the mains question, viewers. Today, we do not have any quiz question. We'll take up a quiz question in our next session. Now, this mains question is based on the discussion of today. Answer this question and interested aspirants can post that answer in the comment section for peer review. So with this discussion, we have come to the end of today's Hindi news analysis and the practice questions discussion session. So as usual, viewers, if you like this video, don't forget to like, comment and share and subscribe to our YouTube channel for receiving updates related to civil services preparation. Thank you.